Make no mistake, the people you choose to let into your life directly impact who you are and what you can achieve. Swati Nakshatra is about our individuality and how we cultivate our individuality by the resistance that we face, and also how we create spaces to be able to learn. The symbol of Swati is the shoot of a plant blowing in the wind. And the significance of that is that the deity, Vayu, is literally the wind. And when we think about the growth and the sustaining of any kind of life, we can see the sun, we can see the earth, we can feel the rain, but we always forget about the wind because it's invisible. However, the wind plays an important role. Wind serves as resistance, and resistance is something we have to force our way through or work our way through. And so in doing that, it makes us stronger. Another key element is the basis of above and below, the basis of within and without. Spiritual growth is not necessarily evident in the outside world. It's an interior process. However, it cannot take place if we don't engage with the material world. The energy of Swati is about growth and learning, and the energy understands that you can't do that without engaging in the material plane. So here are some ways that Swati expresses itself. The first characteristic is being very childlike. As an example, Montessori schools and Waldorf method give children a nurturing atmosphere and let them learn through imagination, so they create a safe space. In the same way, Swati natives will see the world as a place full of toys, and a place of imagination, and a place of play. So one of the ways that space is created is in this childlike atmosphere to be able to cultivate learning through imagination. Swati natives will also engage in conversation with the same childlike wonder, where they're very inquisitive, they're asking questions. So a lot of talk show hosts have Swati. Joe Rogan, Johnny Carson, Jenny McCarthy, Whoopi Goldberg, Star Jones. And by asking questions, they fuel the ego of their guests, they amplify the excitement of the other person, and they really use warmth to create a supportive atmosphere where the other person feels really good and the other person can be individuated. The other person can feel really supported and talk about what they're really about. And this is opposite from the typical worldly aspect where we're trying to prove ourselves. Swati works in the opposite way. The joy of Swati comes from others being able to express themselves. So they have this sweet, devoted, feminine, puppy-like energy with people who hug a lot and make people happy and are just really supportive of others. So when Swati natives are so immersed in another person and talking with another person, it almost becomes like they're hypnotized, almost like they're drunk or they're high or something like this, because Swati uses yin energy, and yin energy is very expansive. So you'll notice Swati natives have big eyes, like Rahu eyes. And what this is inviting the other person to tell you more, to be themselves, to really open up. But yin is this expansive energy that people do drugs to also feel. And because the Swati natives are so gentle and childlike and happy and supportive and excitable, it almost seems like they're on a substance. And then interestingly, a lot of Swati natives are on substance. In fact, some natives are known for it. It's just one of the characteristics of them. Now with drug use, one of the things that, especially smoking marijuana, that it's known for is an intense focus on your surroundings or an intense focus on just what's in front of you. And this is another characteristic of Swati. Swati is obsessed with material harmony. It's the most balanced and stable stage of Rahu, and Rahu being the yin energy, the projection of consciousness into Libra, beautiful things, so naturally lends itself to fashion. Two natives I found with this nakshatra are Karl Lagerfeld, who created this world of Chanel, and you see natives of one nakshatra will often hang out with other natives of that nakshatra, as you see here. And another native is Anna Wintour, the notorious editor of Vogue. Both of them demonstrate this fierce concentration of detail. And with Anna Wintour, her leadership style, how she describes it, is you have to look straight ahead in order to achieve what you are setting out to do. You can't look to the right, you can't look to the left, you can't be wondering what other people are doing, you can't be wondering what other people are saying. You have to remain intensely focused on your goal. And this is her leadership style, which again, as a woman, is not particularly well regarded, but it really demonstrates the swati. So imagine if somebody smoking weed is very, very intensely focused on something right in front of them. She focuses that onto her work. And it's the same with Karl Lagerfeld. They focus it onto their work, and then they can project this and amplify their energy into building an empire, into building a world. Swati native Joe Rogan also talks about this and the intense focus that it requires to become successful. And he too is another person who is able to focus on and amplify his career. He's just not another person who does podcasts. He is the person who does podcasts. He's the preeminent in his space. And this is what Swati does. Now, it's often said that somebody who focuses so hard and is so individuated, we consider them self-centered because they're only concerned with themselves. And that is exactly what this energy is, very self-centered. Imagine what this looks like, though, in a spiritual sense. Even focus on the mundane. Focus on anything. Direct, incredible focus on something is what cultivates a practice and is what cultivates devotion. And so those skills and that dedication that we can get from cultivating some effort continuously and directing our focus to something on the material plane, those are spiritual skills. Now let's take that concept and expand on it. So we've been talking about creating spaces to be nurtured and supported, little worlds that people create for children to learn, or really supportive atmospheres, like where people feel good to be themselves and people can express themselves, but where you can learn. Expressed in a different way, this looks more like virtual reality. There's this famous scene from The Matrix where Neo is downloaded with all of these programs. And on a more advanced level, this is what Swati allows for. Swati is associated with lucid dreaming and with astral projection. So it's, again, the projection of consciousness to other places. And this is where we really get to see what we are about. Because how you behave in a dream, your consciousness on the earth plane and your consciousness in the dream world, it's the same consciousness. So how you act when you don't have the social restraints of the material world, this is really who you are. So you see, dreams, in a way, are a method of learning. And how you conduct yourself, it actually is your emotional state, how you react to something, what you would do, how you would handle things, how you would go about things, what you seek to learn. And what the dream world and the waking world have in common is that all of it around us is our consciousness immersed in illusion. And the lesson of Swati is for us to know the difference and to be able to discern what we are involved in, how we are involved in it, and what around us is illusory, because in fact it is all illusory. And what this means in a more practical sense when it comes to conflict is, are you running your own program or are you in the simulation of somebody else? And here's the lesson of Swati. Maya is illusion, and we are immersed in illusion. Remember back at the beginning, we're talking about wind. Illusion and wind are quite comparable because they are the resistance that we face. There's this new agey idea right now that your brain can be rewired and somehow that will fix you. And that is so not the case. We each have a spiritual path, and on that path, we have particular lessons that are unique to us in what it is that we need to accomplish. Because if we're to do our work in the world, there are things that we as individuals need to learn. So while other people can give you general guidelines for what that might look like or how you may stay in the parameters, those parameters are up to you. You are the one who is swimming in your own sea of experiences. And the way that you learn is by amassing experiences. So it's like a video game where level one is rather simplistic. You learn level one, you can easily surpass it. Level two takes a little bit longer. There are more things, there are more tricks, things are coming at you a little more hidden, and so on and so forth. So when we're learning through our experiences, nobody ever said this was going to be easy. In fact, the more important your work, probably the more difficult it's going to be. And the way that you achieve the different levels is by learning what goes on. Because when challenges present themselves, when resistance presents itself, when the wind comes to you, each time it comes harder. Even if you don't happen to consider yourself on a spiritual path, you'll notice the same problem will show up in your life wearing a different face. The same dynamic will show up in your workplace, in your social life. It will look different and the circumstances seem different, so you think it's different, but it's really the same thing, just disguised differently. And on a spiritual path or just in the world, what happens is that it's up to you to be able to identify what are the illusions that are really covering up, shading, you know, think about fashion. What are the things that are adorning this problem to make it seem like it's something different? And when you come to the point where you can recognize that problem, regardless if it's been around for a while, if it develops slowly, if it comes out of left field, but no matter what clothes it's wearing, no matter what costume it's wearing, no matter what simulation it's part of, no matter how it shows up, you know what that problem is. You know the baseline of that problem. You know the baseline of that issue and how it impedes your life. And that is the point of Swati. One final element is that Swati is Vayu, prana, life force. So it's the breath that connects you to your consciousness. Without any other function you could live, without breath, you cannot live, you cannot survive. So prana is not only what connects you to your brain, your thinking, your psyche, but also what connects you to the universe. In deciding how you spend your time, what simulation you are in, who's around you, Swati wants you to see what you are breathing life into. Because by engaging with certain people, by engaging in certain activities, by engaging on a certain path instead of another one, you are creating your reality, and whoever you are around, whatever endeavor you are a part of, this is what you breathe life into. Virgo, sun, moon, and rising. This full moon energy is taking place in your second house, and your second house has to do with esteem, and it has to do with your material accumulation. So, how you feel about yourself and what you have to show for yourself, what you have to show for your efforts. And what the full moon energy is asking you to look at is what you're breathing life into as far as your esteem. Are you feeling about yourself the way that you actually feel about yourself, or are you feeling about yourself influenced by some other way? And I'll explain. Second house is across from eighth house, right? So eighth house has to do with shared resources, it has to do with intimacy, and it also has to do with secrets. It has to do with deep psychological things like shame and how you feel about money and issues of the past. And so kind of it's very much the shadow aspect. So how you feel about yourself now and what your efforts are now, what your material stuff looks like is not always representative of your efforts. The popular thing to say is that it is, but the fact is it isn't. There are many things that can go differently than how you set out. So what your bank account looks like, what your house looks like, what your possessions look like may not be representative of what you've tried. And they may not be representative of what you've put into something. That's your stuff. Your esteem is something different. And because in a worldly sense, we put esteem with our stuff, you see, it begins to impede. The two begin to overlap. So what the full moon energy is asking you to do is look at this. When it comes to your esteem, when it comes to how you feel about yourself, what are you breathing life into? Are you breathing life into the effort that you put in every day? The way that you show up in the world every day? How you take care of yourself? How you see about your spiritual path? How you see about your surroundings? The effort that you make on a day-to-day basis? Or are you being influenced by the shadows of the past? Are you being influenced by these elements that are, maybe you've had to accept help from people, or maybe you're in a shared situation that you don't really love, and it makes you feel like you should have been able to do it yourself, right? So that impedes on your esteem because you feel like you should be someplace else. When it comes to your spiritual path, when it comes to your internal worth, the external doesn't have anything to do with that. Actually with Swati, it talks about the strange happenings of Vayu that are happening above with the non-accomplishments of below. So even Swati Nakshatra, it's very specific about the fact that what's happening like internally above the cosmos, but like inside the cosmos, what your spiritual development is like is not represented on the material plane. That's a people idea. That's not a spiritual idea. So how you feel about yourself and how you feel you should have done or where you feel you should be, That's the program you're in. So is the program you're in, is this about you and how you feel about you? Or is this about how other people and worldly elements are telling you you should feel about you? What of this are you humoring, right? What are you breathing life into? Are you breathing life into these narratives, these stupid things that are telling you that you didn't accomplish, that you didn't get where you are, or you're never going to get where you are, you should have been someplace different? If you're humoring those, if you're listening to those, if you're even in those conversations, you're breathing life into them. Versus if you are breathing life into your own endeavors and separating those aside, right? So to get to it, what the Swati energy is asking you to do is look at, what are you breathing life into? Does it have to do with you, or does it have to do with external? Whose simulation are you running, right? Who's in charge? Is it you, or is it what's being imposed on you? Are you in somebody else's game? And if you are in somebody else's game and you are susceptible to what's being imposed on you, how can you individuate yourself? How can you separate from that in a way that you step forward in your life and you continue to do things in your life that you created, that you have driven from your spiritual sense, from your center, from your core? You're stepping into your life, and the program that you create is what you create, not what someone else has imposed upon you. Moon chart is all about being careful who you surround yourself with. In the chart itself, the moon is right on the line of 10th and 11th house. So 10th house is your career, your public reputation, how you're known in the world. And your 11th house are your friends, your networks, and your associations. So who you are around and kind of what you're going to be known for. And it's opposing a ton of planets in the 5th house. So you have Sun, Mercury, Venus, and Uranus. So what you're paying attention to, how you're thinking, how you're expressing yourself, what you're loving. Fifth house is what you bring into the world, your creative endeavors. And it's in Bharani Nakshatra, which actually, like, the symbol for Bharani is actually a vagina. So it's birthing, like, it's really what you're bringing into the world. And those are all squared by Saturn. So it means whatever structures you were doing, whatever you were, this indicates attachments. So whatever structures you were used to doing, how you were used to going about things, thinking about things, talking about things, what you're trying to bring into the world is going to require a change. And what the moon energy is doing, because the moon, a full moon, only reflects back the light that is currently there. And so what this moon is saying is, look at who you are around and what you're putting out into the world, what you want your public reputation to be, who you are attaching yourself with, because that is going to affect what you create. Make no mistake, the people you are around, the activities, the endeavors you align yourself with, this is what you become. The chart ascendant is in Jyeshtha, and Jyeshtha is about maneuvering. Jyeshtha is, remember from the last video, it's the opposite of Ravati. where Ravati is very nurturing energy. In Ravati, the way to gain power is to nurture, to care for animals and children and drink milk. Not in Jyeshtha. In Jyeshtha, the way to gain power is by manipulation, by political maneuvering, by lies, by working in the shadows. So this is what the chart is about. This is not an easygoing chart. This chart is saying pay very close attention because something isn't right. Pay very close attention to who you are around and what is going on, because what you're going to be known for or what's possibly going to interfere with you, that's going to affect what you're able to bring into the world. This video has some cards with it. All right, the first one, the Two of Swords. It means that you have a decision that you're facing. The Two of Wands, you have worked very hard to get where you are. You know what you're doing and you've worked really hard to establish it, and you might need a rest, but you've really set up the groundwork. The Ten of Wands, this is about a burden that you're carrying. But with the Ten of Wands, something has happened where you'll no longer carry that burden. Although you can be hurt by something, you can be betrayed by people, but it will be the last time. The 10, the completion. So whatever decision you're facing, you've worked hard, you're still set up, and don't be afraid of the end of something because it can't hurt you anymore. When you put down this load, all that happens is that you have more energy to move forward. On a final note, if you feel like doing a ritual this time, a good ritual would involve fire. Whatever ritual you decide to do, there are two elements that cannot be contaminated. That's ether and fire. And as we are stepping into this Vedic New Year, and as we are stepping into the future of our endeavors, and stepping forward with all the work that we've done to begin to create something, it's the perfect time to decide what you're no longer breathing life into, severing your ties to that simulation, and stepping forward.